reaction to when you found out Chappie, the owner, was actually a fourth generation Spanish person from the Philippines?
Colonizer! He's very nice, everyone come here.
This is Culture Table, a series where we sit down with different Asian comedians to have the funny conversations you thought you'd never get to have, but that you need to have. This is the Filipino episode with comedians Marcus, Jordan, and Ileana, where we address assimilation, stereotypes, comedy, and where Filipinos fit into the rise of Asia.
All right, everybody, welcome to another episode of Culture Table. With us today, we have three Filipino comedians based in New York.
Marcus Cardona, first generation, born Filipino-American, from Maine, living in Brooklyn.
I'm Jordan Mendoza. My parents were born in Manila. My brother was born in Manila, but I was born in Boston.
Hi, Ileana Inocencio. My dad was born in Altavas, Aklan, and I was born in Virginia.
And you guys are all professional comedians.
Yeah.
That's not a common job for Asians to be pro at least. I think more and more Asians, like in 2020, they're like dabbling in it.
Yeah,
I took an improv class in college, but as far as like, man, I gotta live the rest of my life check by check on a comedy check. That's new.
Oh, thank you. Yeah,
cool. Yeah, go ahead and you can bring it down to the camera. Oh.
This is our alige pasta. This is the top selling dish here in Chismes for dinner. The tocino yempo, the pineapple tocino yempo, is the second favorite of the silog dishes here in Chismes. And we have the bangus, which is the milkfish, which is indigenous to our waters in the Philippines. We actually bring this product all the way from Davao. Lastly is the chorizo benedict, which is our take on the traditional American eggs benedict. But instead of using a Canadian bacon, we do a sweet pork patty.
Filipino Americans may or may not have a little bit more leeway due to the westernization of the culture. Like the parents might be a little bit more okay with it that you pursue the arts. But was it a difficult journey to kind of get to that point where you're like making people laugh for the rest of my life?
I don't think so. My dad and my mom were always really supportive. I think they were harder on my brother because he's older, he's the boy, and you know, my mom's from Singapore, so there's that, like, I guess, like more Chinese influence in there.
I'd never felt free to do what I wanted to do. I was going to be a doctor, and then when I wasn't going to be a doctor, my parents were like, well, he'll be a lawyer then, that's great. I moved to New York to be an artist, like a photographer and a video artist, and then I got into comedy and my parents were like, no.
So I argued so hard for this, like with my family. It was funny because like I did like the complete like stereotypical route. I was like a nursing student and then I was like doing comedy at the time. It was like I basically fought against that stereotype a bunch and then I just had to keep pushing through because like my parents like didn't like really see. They'd be like, oh, why do you waste so much time doing this? But then after that, like, you know, because of that, like, I had a real voice and I could actually talk with my parents.
Yo, you guys, when you guys look at this food, this is the Filipino-American culture table.
Garlic fried rice is very familiar. Yeah. The top silog, for sure, because I would always have lap silog, which was like the sweet sausage version of that.
Yeah, me too.
So I love that. The other stuff looks different.
Your reaction to when you found out Chappie, the owner, was actually a fourth generation Spanish person from the Philippines.
Colonizer!
He's very nice, everyone come here.
I am part Spanish.
Oh, you are part Spanish.
I am descended from a Spanish priest.
What percentage, like, did you take 23andMe to find out?
Yeah, I actually just took 23andMe.
How Spanish are you, man?
I am 8%.
We're all Spanish influence, so I think you should not pick.
I think in like American culture, when you're an Asian, you're at the buffet and you can either choose to eat from the black section or the white section. The Asian section is so small and or like non-existent really. So that's why you see so many Asians who are like, oh, they're a white Asian, they're banana, or they're a black Asian.
A rotten banana, right?
Yeah. Now. Right, is that what that's called?
You guys never heard that term?
Rotten banana.
Call it a yellow M&M.
Oh, interesting.
Oh, yeah.
And then obviously the white version is a Twinkie. You guys have heard that, right?
I've heard Twinkie, yeah.
Different people, even in the same immediate family, might eat from different parts of the buffet.
Yeah.
The kids are all gonna pick one, a more stronger angle in unity. For Asians, it's like, it's a crapshoot.
Yeah.
And I want to ask this because I think this is a great segue where being Chinese and knowing so many Filipinos growing up, I was like, yo, Filipinos are so into subculture, whether it's they're kind of more emo playing the guitar or whether they're playing basketball or they're trying to be rappers or they're breakdancers. There's so much subculture. What do you think bred that? Like, it seems more than other Asians personally.
Yeah, like just like how Americans influenced Filipinos way back in the 50s anyways.
Yeah.
So I feel like we always had that aspiration to be more American. So I think we had that like weird upper hand before coming to America.
Because of colonization, Americans installed this ideal that the ideal is going to be that you are an American, like a white American. So that I think that's why we are always searching for some kind of subculture to attach ourselves to, because it's going to make us feel like we can upgrade our race in a way.
We're just talking about subcultures. Like, if you're like a Filipino, you actually like go into like self-identity, all you realize is like colonization. And even like here, like when I grew up, my parents used to like be like, oh, like, you know, I have an American name, and they'd be like, oh, you should like diminish that. Then when we go back to Philippines, I'd have like a cultural disconnect, because they're like, oh, you're American. Or Filipinos changing to like being black. I'm like, that's also another thing, because like during that time also, black nerds started popping up, and I'm like, that's where like, I was like, why am I popular now?
I think Filipinos being in the military. Yeah. San Diego has a lot, there's a military base there.
Yeah.
I knew a lot of the Filipinos growing up. Their parents were part in the military
Too.
Yeah,
that's where my dad joined the US Navy like years ago, and that's how he came over here. So all of like the Filipinos I knew were like military guys and then their kids.
Mine's weird, because like my parents didn't meet in the Philippines. They met in Maine.
Because you were kind of referencing colonization and the levels, different layers of assimilation the Filipinos have been through. It's funny, other Asians, sometimes we have beef with our upbringing because our groups are not assimilated enough.
Like, obviously, like, everyone, like, you know, kind of has, like, an issue with, like, colonization, but, like, so much of the existing current culture is from that. Like, I'm friends with a lot of, like, Viet friends, and, like, theirs is, like, you know, Vietnamese and, like, French, and, like, that's why they have, like, the banh mi and all that stuff. But culturally, like, you know, it's just, like, you wouldn't be who you were without all that happened.
Right, right. That's the woke thing to say, is, like, it was bad.
Yeah.
But then what? Is everybody going to stop eating banh mi's?
Yeah.
Or is everybody going to... Are you guys chucking Jollibees out the door? Because that is not Filipino food.
I'm not throwing away fish sauce, absolutely not.
I lived in a very white town around white people, and I was like, I really just want to fit in. I think as a kid, you just want to fit in. Now, I am very curious about what our culture actually is, but also, not at all, because I haven't done anything about it, so whatever.
Do you think that you guys had different Filipino upbringings? Because in a way, you guys, and you know, the crazy thing is, being a mixed country, everybody in the Philippines looks so different. You know, you totally could be somebody in the Philippines, you could be somebody in the Philippines, you could be somebody in the Philippines. But it's almost like you guys' 23s and me's probably look like pretty different from each other in a way.
Yeah.
Similar but different.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, do you think that experience of even just looking different but still being under the same umbrella Filipino culture changes the way you interface with it?
Yeah, definitely, for sure. Like, it's definitely one of those weird interaction ones. Like, if I find out that we're both Filipino, usually like I'm like kind of more cool with you.
It's not like it has to be the exact same type of Filipino.
No, if you're just Filipino, if we can talk about anything. If Bruno Mars comes on and you start dancing, and then you look at me and you like make a point, it's like, yeah.
I mean, I get Chinese a lot, actually. I don't always get seen as Filipino first. Honestly, it depends on how like brown I am during the season.
Like, my best friend from high school is Filipino, but when we first met, like, the diversity director at our high school was like, you guys should meet because you're both Filipino.
Mm-hmm.
We shook hands and we went our separate ways because we were like, this kid, I'm not just Filipino, I'm my own person.
Didn't you say that in a way you were like eating from the white side of the buffet and your friend was eating from like the black side
of the
buffet?
That's right, yeah. My friend likes to say that I'm the white version of him and then he's the black version of me.
Can you talk about that mind meld? Because I think that is a topic I want to touch upon, because we're talking about assimilation. I feel like I learned my ability to assimilate into American subcultures from my Filipino friends, because I definitely was not going to learn it from the Chinese kids at church, because they just didn't do it. And you're saying, you know, your best friend is like the black version of you, and you're like the white version of him, but you guys are melded by that Filipino mind meld.
Yeah.
What is that? Could you guys, I want to just make the section that's like some, like the Filipino mind meld. What is it, even though you may, or your brother, or your cousins may have all adopted a different American subculture, you guys all still got that, you know,
right?
We're still Filipino.
I think it is that like kindness of the Filipinos, because like any Filipino house I went to growing up was like an auntie coming to me like, did you eat yet? You know, and I feel like just being around that and growing up, you automatically want to be that way with the other Filipinos you meet. And also on a superficial level, it's like, oh, they look like me, they're my family, you know, and it's like you want to care for your family instinctively.
That's the core that's going to bond them.
Yeah.
Family is very important to Filipino culture, although I wonder how much of that comes from Spanish culture. So, you know what? Family. I hate you, mom and dad, if you're watching
this. Hey, are you trying to become
he's Korean. I feel like, there's talking about family stuff, but I feel like Filipino, like, just food, that's like a big bonding one. Because like they do like the Kamayan meals, which is like a big popular thing. And then beyond that, a weird one is like the Balik Bayan box, which is like something that like most families do, where you grab stuff and you send it back to the Philippines. So that's where like a weird like unity, even if you're in America. It's more like little things. Like if they point with their lips, I'm like, gosh, yeah, we're both Filipino. Or if you're walking to an airport and you go, shh, like if you see a head turn, I'm like, oh yeah, that guy's Filipino. Yeah. That's like a weird like thing that's just family from like parents and stuff like that.
No, what does that mean? It's like that's getting your attention.
That's all it is.
Yeah, that does feel like peasant stuff.
Everybody kind of has their own lane. I'm sure you guys all have your own audience. What do you guys think about Joe Coy?
Joe Coy's beast. Man, like Joe Coy, he's so good and he like gets like the stereotypes right about Filipinos that every time he writes a special, I have to like cut out chunks of my joke book.
Oh no.
Like down.
That's no.
A lot of militant Filipinos are going around. They said he's kind of like a fake Filipino.
Yeah.
Like he kind of like
he's a fake Filipino?
Yeah, like he's only half. And then his mom doesn't have that accent.
Yeah.
And his upbringing was much more whiter. And he sort of like extrapolated on the fob aspects to have an act.
Oh.
He still has it. It's just exaggerated, which on stage, like, we're acting.
I also have to cut a lot of Joe Coy jokes from my sets as well.
That's not true.
A crossover.
That is not
Joe Coy, you've been stealing my style for years now.
I think he appeals to Filipinos, like my parents' generation, you know? So
it's, at the end of the day, it's comforting to know that there's a guy making Filipino jokes that's making that much money, right?
Yeah.
And is that successful, right? You need to see that. Is there any sense that you feel like you need to lean into this style of comedy, like make more Filipino jokes, or you're like, I want to lean out for that reason? Like, what are those reasonings that you have behind your comedy?
Joe Coy doesn't really talk about money. Then you get to see like different nations talk about it. Like Ryan Chang talks about money in his set. Ali Wong talks about money in his set. Joe Coy kind of talks about it, but he just plays on like the bigger stereotypes everyone knows.
Right.
So I had to do it like from Filipino's perspective, because I've talked about how poor the country is.
Right.
And I'm like, no one wants to have the conversation, but I feel like that's the whole point of like my comedy in general. Is I make the harder conversations funny, that you can joke about it. I'm like, it exists.
Real quick, just one specific joke did you do?
Like behind every successful Asian man is like an Asian mom who beat him into success. Like the more you got beat, the like higher successful you are. And I'm like, on the flip side, if you ever see like an Asian woman collecting cans, she's just trying to replace the son she doesn't have. And my sister's I'm just like, that's real.
Damn. All right, yeah.
We had a joke that we used to do years back about growing up and hearing this split decision between Filipinos, where Filipinos would be Asian for the good stereotypes and the Pacific Islander when the Asian stereotypes got really bad. Like,
wow.
Oh, we're good at school, we're really smart, we're Asian, small No, we're Pacific Islanders. Like, hold on.
We're much more like the Rock, Samoan, Polynesian.
Yeah, these guys, that's us when it comes to the dick game. Yeah, so
I was in a meeting, like a general meeting with someone, an exec, and they were like, what's your comedy like? And I went, I freaked out, but I liked, like, inspired by, I like Zach Galifianakis a lot. I look at what, like, Taika Waititi did with his career, and I'm like, that's exactly what I want to do.
Do you think being Asian will either help or hurt that? It's true that obscure, oddball comedy, typically, even though highly regarded as difficult to do, more of a white thing. Maybe the closest thing is a Hannibal Buress, and even he's kind of linear, but he's considered an oddball black comedian.
I've just been like, how do I make this joke work? I've never really thought about it.
Aren't you guys from round two? What was your favorite?
Like the alige?
Yeah, the pasta. That was really good.
I like the fish, whatever that was called. So.
And the bangos?
Bangos.
Yeah.
This is just like a weird sandwich, like Filipino. I like the lechon. That was really good. That's like, pork belly.
We're onto the dessert section, you guys. I had a question because, you know, we're all in comedy. What do you guys feel about, like, how you guys, like, look and how it affects the comedy, right? My whole perspective on it has always been, in terms of a widespread mainstream level, we're really years away from having an Asian Seinfeld, because people just can't get over how different of a culture we represent.
Well, I mean, like I was saying, I actually have like an all Asian sketch group and pitched a show to UCB, which was at the time a predominantly like white male community, and then we got a run. We were smart enough to know that this is what they would want of us, because there had never been an Asian group that had a show there. So we were like, okay, we gotta do it this way in order to get our foot in to create the stuff we wanna do. That was like 5 years ago, and I think that's changed so much.
But how did you feel? Because you said, even, I'm not gonna lie, one of my one Asian joke
does super well.
I think people, yeah, they really want you to be the thing that
they're like,
they
come
see.
On, crazy rich Asians. I know you got it.
It's like, that's just racism.
Does your part white side feel some white privilege to be like, I don't need to talk about the sandals every other minute?
I really hope that one day I can feel more white privilege.
Maybe you should just announce to people, you should bring the 23andMe results. I always thought my friends that were Filipino, that were trying to be comedians, said that they were trying to not talk about being Asian because people couldn't immediately identify them as Asian.
Right.
Like conventionally Asian, I'm not saying yeah. like, that's not Asian, but like, because I was like, oh yeah, visually they have more leeway to get away with like
that's true.
Being seen as something else.
Yeah.
I benefit from some sort of like mixed privilege of like, we don't know what it is, so he can do whatever he wants.
You mean the same thing Vin Diesel has or like...
Right, like what's up with Vin Diesel?
Or The Rock, there's like,
Rock.
Put him in something.
Right.
He'll grab a couple demographics.
Yeah.
I could see your ambiguous racial look being a benefit in certain systems,
yeah.
but if they come to you for that Asian hour-long special, it'll be a con.
Yeah. I remember auditioning for like a summer stock thing where it was like they were doing King and I and Miss Saigon. And then I went in on audition and the casting director was basically like, you're good, but you don't look Asian enough.
I've like literally had like audiences be on my side and like they're Latino and I say I'm Filipino and I just hear like a sigh in the audience, like, oh, we thought it was one of ours. I'd say it's like a lot of my comedy setup is like misdirect anyway, so I'm like, if they don't know what I am, then I can just kind of play the field.
I wanted to ask you guys about Filipino representation in the mainstream as all this other Asian stuff is going up, this particularly East Asian looking, whether it's K-pop, you know, even Awkwafina's rock. Or like Crazy Rich Asians, which are more Chinese based. I think Filipinos had their time, you know, 10, 12 years ago. But yeah, it's not really including Filipinos right now.
I think the issue though is like already what you're bringing up here. Like we're all Filipino, but we all don't look like the same race. You can't make a family sitcom because it might look very different.
You have to be 100% Korean to be the place.
Yeah.
I always thought that the Filipino advantage of being racially ambiguous was good 10 years ago, growing up in real life, like just on the streets.
Mm.
And then it's weird in a media way. When you sell it to a media company, then they're like, oh, we just wanted them. It's sort of a give and take. Would you guys take the higher risk of not fitting into Western society as a person in your personal life, but you get the easier typecasting for roles?
Yeah, what are you gonna...
What are you gonna do?
Japanese?
Yeah,
one, two, three, we're all Japanese. Yeah.
But even just like having like Filipinos in writers' rooms, because we're always like the digital editors, the choreographers.
To answer that question, you're like, dude, it's not about just being able to physically look like an Asian, Asian that Hollywood sees as an Asian.
Yeah.
You're like, it's about just getting all the way through the system.
And me, Japanese.
Background and on camera.
And honestly, like whatever culture you need me to be, I'll just like be that. So
this is Jordan's video of selling out entirely.
Man, in a way, the people I see making it right now, they can emote and be family, like gregarious, like a Filipino, but they don't necessarily, they have a more Asian-y look.
I don't think it's like, oh, Filipinos really had their time only 10 years ago and then that's it. I'm like, not really.
Whatever.
It'll all come around and everybody's gonna be able to do everything, and ultimately, like, as Asians come up and diverse faces come up, I do think generally it's still good for everybody.
Did you guys watch the debut?
Oh, I did.
Yeah. What is this?
Don't.
Rufio. Shame.
Rufio, great. I don't know who that is
Rufio
either.
Rufio was like our mascot for like years.
Shame.
Oh my gosh.
Yes, I told you, I'm Spanish or Japanese. I'm not Filipino. Alright, this is my application video for Terrace House, right? So, thank you so much for the food.
This is Toshikado de Guzman. What do you guys hope for the future of Filipinos in America?
Here's what I think is gonna happen. You know, I think Filipinos are already everywhere, so I think we're kind of like a sniper. We're gonna like show up and then all of a sudden it's gonna be all Filipinos everywhere, like on camera, behind camera, like everything. Because I think that assimilation is something that is like our strength.
Like Asian August, like that time when like, was that when Crazy Rich Asians and Searching and To All the Boys I Loved Before, all that came out, that was great. But it should just be about not like these peaks and valleys, but like this just like
consistency.
Yeah. Like I was at Trader Joe's and they had an ube ice cream like months ago, and I was like, that's awesome, I'm gonna keep buying it. And then it went away. I missed the ube ice cream.
The way that I see it is just about investment in like the next thing. I'm like, okay, so we've seen the K-pop people, we've seen like, you know, Nora from Queens. No matter what, they're gonna be like, oh man, I wish I had a show that had like some kind of black people, some kind of white people, Asian people, some Latino people. I'm like, oh, crazy. Filipinos, like that's what I feel like is gonna make the next switch.
I've assembled all five special cards, all five pieces of the puzzle. Exodia, obliterate!
Like, you ever like, damn, like, that's weird that we gotta even have that, like, question about, like, how the group's gonna, like, impact our careers? Or should we just exist as, like, solo units? Because theoretically, that's how, if we were all, like, blue people,
yeah,
that's how it would be, right? There wouldn't be any movement of, like, lighter shade blue. Like, we're all just one color of blue. Mm-hmm. It's just, like, everybody on their own. But because we're Asian, there is some sense of, like, damn, I really hope they make, like, 3 Filipino sitcoms on NBC next year, because I'm going out for that.
Yeah. And if that happens, like, I'm Filipino. So, if you guys are looking for, like, I can do the accent, like, I'll do whatever you want.
It's like when people came out of Black Panther, I saw people coming out there, I was like, all right, these are changes. I'm like, all right, bye Koreans, bye Japanese. I'm just gonna walk by myself.
So eventually they're gonna come to all the Asians at some point.
We're like
and
phase
then...
3 in the ACU, though.
Yeah.
Well, what's one project that you guys would like to see? Because if anybody's watching this out there and they like any of you guys, like, what's something that you're either working on that you want to pitch, or just like throwing it out there, like, yo, I want to see debut number 2.
I might just try pitching like a fictional, like, National Treasure story about General Tsao, and then all you guys know about is the chicken. Funny. So that's it.
Okay. I wrote a Marie Kondo rom-com recently, and I really like the premise is that it's about a Marie Kondo-esque person who believes objects have feelings and falls in love with a client and his lamp. So it's a like a psychological sort of sexual comedy.
Who are you hiring as a cast?
Who you know who I like is the person from Maniac.
Some freaky kind of freaky deaky Japanese stuff. Is that one, the one you're writing with Fumi?
The show that Fumi and I are writing is called We're Asian Now, and it's about, like, in your 20s, having, like, this late adolescence and realizing, like, oh, yeah, I am Asian. And it's a sketch show.
For me, my group Asian Pop is working on a pilot right now. So the thing that is cool about Asian Pop is that we each represent a different Asian country. So we wrote a pilot that we're trying to pitch around. It's basically,
what countries you got in there?
India, China, Japan, and Philippines.
I've got all the big ones.
Yeah, major players.
Why'd you leave out the Koreans? Well, let's be honest, the Koreans, they didn't want to be a part of it.
The Koreans have all the pop groups right now, so they have
everything else going on. So but we have like a pilot about how basically all these Asian women date one white guy, and it like comes into fruition. It's very good.
So this is based on a true story, of course. We know that.
All of the guys here shook our heads and were like, shame.
No, because we knew it was true. No, I'm just kidding.
But it's like, is this guy is bad? He's the villain. So
okay, that's funny.
Yeah. What was your guys' favorite dessert that we had?
Ooh.
I like the corn bibinca the most.
So I like this one. Just bibinca's just other ratatouille dish. I was like, child.
I like the Silvana. I've never had that before. It's good.
I actually like that ube puree French toast.
Yeah,
that's, oh, yeah,
that was like really. I know that was the fusion dish, but yeah, that was good as hell. What do you think it is, guys, that made Filipinos have and continue to have this reputation of being like, you know, always down for a laugh, dancing, jovial? Where did that like joy come from?
Oh,
happiness
is free. That's why. It's happiness is free. That's it. Like, I feel like I thought about it because I'm like, most of it is like, yeah, we drink and eat and stuff like that, like in our free time, like karaoke and stuff like that. But I'm like, if we had the karaoke machine, we'd rather do it at home rather than go out. It's because happiness is free. That's in my opinion.
And also, I guess, island life. Because like Philippines, even though there are cities, it's 7,000 islands. So it's like, we have that like chill culture.
That's my Filipino joke is that.
I think we are very NBC sitcom. Like, I think we're accessible, you know? We're network TV.
Historically speaking. No, I am NBC sitcom.
No, you're not.
I'm NBC. Sitcom.
Wait, did you guys notice that in the beginning?
Or ABC, whichever one.
Whichever
one. That when they first started really coming to America, there was this sense that Filipinos were taking white women. And that's the only Asian group. That's the only Asian group that I heard that from.
I primarily dated white women, and then a couple of years ago, I was like, oh my god, am I racist? Like, so I started like. Actively dating Asian women. And then I would have dinners with them and they would also be like, are you like only into Asian women? And I'll be like, no, I'm new to this. And then they were like, me too. I think there's like a cultural thing of like, okay, now we can date each other again and it not
be
seen as we only date within our race.
He was just talking about like dating Asians. Like it was hard for me to date Asian girls because it was like super Asian, like girl who's like, I can date a doctor, trying to date up, that weird like Pride and Prejudice type thing. That was like a weird thing because I'm a Filipino and I used to do comedy and they're like, oh. I never felt like I got to dictate who I dated or who was attracted to me, because I think the reason why black girls liked me early on was, do you remember Roger and Hammerstein's like Cinderella with Brandy? Prince was Filipino.
And then
Dante Bosco was like this recent thing, and then like all of a sudden like Puerto Ricans like 2 years ago because Bruno Mars and Cardi B came out with that thing. They're just like, oh, you're cute now. I'm like, why?
What advice do you guys have to people from other Asian groups that are not necessarily born with that same, like, I guess, inherent openness?
Or you literally, like, no, if you're just not born Filipino, you're inspired. It's not in the cards for you to play that chameleon.
I kind of feel that, like, it's hard.
Oh, God.
don't be a comedian. Don't just say that PC, like, star shooting across the sky, like, now you know answer.
Well, like, you know, like, we can't even figure out how we're this way, so it's like, how the fuck are you gonna figure it out for yourself? You know, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't have all the answers.
You should just be yourself, which is a lame thing to say. But also, like, I don't know, meditate and, like, take drugs or something like that. Like,
oh, wait, are we talking about, like,
try to, like,
break out of your identity? Brand. Like, I mean, we're all, like, attached to these body bags that we think are our identity. But we're really just a universal consciousness that, like, it's just, like, in the ether. Like, ube ice cream. Like, months ago.
I can do the accent. We're just floating energy. And then this is the casing. No.
We're all the same, but we're also all different.
You know what? I'll end on that. Just like
yo, I want to give a big shout out to Chismas, this restaurant over in the Lower East Side, guys. You guys got to check it out. Check out to Chef Chappie over here.
Thank you, guys. It's been a pleasure hosting you guys. I hope you guys enjoyed the food. Thank you.
Really wonderful. Amazing food here. This is what Culture Table is about. We're just being real, being funny, having the conversation that a lot of people don't have. All right, everybody, thank you so much for watching that episode of Culture Table. And until next time, we out.
Peace.
Yeah.
I always say that Culture Table is like a conversation you might have for like anywhere from 30 seconds to 2 minutes with your friends, but then like drawn out to 90 minutes.
So I'm just glad because like, you know, most times, even in a mixed group of Asian friends, like you're, chances are you're probably not having a conversation like this at this length. So I think it's so cool to be able to have that. And man, they're all involved in some really cool projects. So check them out down below.